What up, players? Welcome back to my How to Paint a Talepic Lander Great Sword for the Empire Army. And today we're going to get started with Evil Sun Scarlet, Wild Rider Red, and Irio Yellow. Flash gets yellow, that's for the red and yellow highlights. We've also got Gehenna's Gold to highlight up the gold. Iron Breaker for all the silver. Cadian Flesh Tone to bring the skin tones up a little bit. Othuan Gray, give him a little bit more salt in his salt and pepper beard. Xandri Dust. Ceramite White. Abadabadabadabadabadablack. Why did I do Xandri Dust twice? I think that was supposed to be Rakarth Flesh. And here's a look at the finished model. So as you can see, what we did was we added slashes of contrasting colors to the puffy sleeves and the puffy trousers, and we also highlighted up the mustache and the beard. The contrasting colors we used, Mephiston Red and Averlyn Sunset, and we gave him some eyeballs. Alright, so this is where we were, where we left off, and we're going to start with Irio Yellow. And if you watch the brushstrokes for highlighting up a color after you shade it, you'll notice that I leave the color in the shading, like right by the codpiece area, and in each of the folds, I leave that browner shade of the wash. I leave it in the folds there, and I just try to hit the ends of the flaps. Irio Yellow is a very, very bright, vibrant yellow, and it's very good for highlighting. I wouldn't use it as a base color because it's already so bright, but as a highlight color, if you've got some of that shading in the recesses to contrast, it's really nice. So again, if you watch my paint strokes, I'm kind of starting from around the middle of each of those flaps, and I'm pulling the paint down towards the folded over cloth. I'm really not trying to touch the upper section where that shading has created the shadows. I'm going to be reading a little section from Sigmar's Heirs. I've got the source book open next to me in case you are thinking you might want to see what kind of men Talabic lenders are, or what the people are like. Flash Gets Yellow is our final highlight. It's a really bright yellow, so this is like the final extreme highlight we're just going to do to really offset the shading on the opposite side. Okay, it says, most of the people of Talabic Land are descendants of the Talutin tribe, and that's who Sigmar gave rulership over all the lands between the Talabic River and the Styr River in the Empire. After years of wandering the Great Forest, the Talabic found the Great Crater, which was a huge bowl in the earth surrounded by a natural wall. The wall itself was pierced by a tunnel. According to legend, Krugar, the chief of the Talabic, decided that this was a sign from the god Ta'al and ordered the building of a great city within the crater. Known first as Talahim, later to become Talabheim, it is the largest city in the east and is considered impregnable. Now, when you think of Middenheim as being on the top of like this giant plateau over the forest and the surrounding lands, then this is kind of like the opposite of that, where it's located within a crater. And now going on to the reds, we've got Evil Sun Scarlet as the first of our highlights. And it says, a thickly forested place, Talabic Land has a reputation for barbarism and ignorance amongst the other provinces. The folk of Talabic Land ignore this nonsense, holding instead a private pride in their forest craft and practical skills. At their best, Talabic Landers are patient woods folk with a quiet intensity and honor. Reading, writing, and the scholastic arts are respected, but they are held in second place to the lore of the wilds. The men of Talibakland favor silence and deed over long speeches, but their womenfolk are considered suckers for a honeyed word. As a consequence, rakish types, poets, and Reichlanders are viewed with firm suspicion throughout the province, though in general, Talibaklanders are more welcoming than their rural Stirling cousins. Now, this is an interesting part that I found. The role of the father is considered especially important. Even town-born men take their sons to the woods for a summer and teach them how to follow a trail, light a fire, and catch a meal. This is considered a matter of practicality, just like a Marienburger who learns to swim since Marienburg is on the ocean. A lad without a father to patiently teach him the ways of the woods and the bow is considered unlucky indeed. Sadly, the storm of chaos has left many a youngster with no means of initiation into the ways of his forefathers. And again, this was a source book for Warhammer Fantasy Roleplay 2nd Edition, and they tried to tie in the giant storm of chaos campaign into the setting of Warhammer Fantasy Roleplay. So, there's lots of references to Archaon and the Storm of Chaos, but they don't really tie in any of that. It's just kind of like in the background. You don't really get to fight Archaon in the campaigns or anything like that. The second highlight is Wild Rider Red, which has like a little bit of a touch of orange. I want to say like maybe 30% orange, 70% red, but as a highlight, fantastic if you're going to use it as a highlight. And you can see how just really almost completely changes the look of these flaps when you highlight with this color. Because Evil Sun Scarlet is just a step up from Mephiston Red as a red color, but Wild Rider Red really almost pulls it into the orange color. Alright, and I'm assuming though that, getting back on the topic of the fluff, that the End Times campaign is really gonna affect the men of Talibheim or Talibakland as well, and the women. I'm not even sure. I gotta look back at the first book, the Nagash book, to see how badly Talibakland is affected by the coming of Nagash, and especially with the Glotkin moving around and attacking right around the same time. It'll be interesting to see. I should go read. If anybody knows, if anybody's a fluff hound, I'd love to hear, because I don't have a copy of the book, the hard copy. I've got it on digital on my iPad, but I'm having trouble loading it up and reading it, I guess because it's such a large file and my iPad is a little bit old, so the old girl has a hard time with those larger sized files. Okay, so this is a step you do not have to take unless you want to with these anyone with slashes. I mean, this is kind of a daunting prospect, but what we're doing is we're putting the shade of the opposing color, the contrasting color, into the slashes. Now, the reason why I say this is kind of a daunting task is because it's very, very easy to become discouraged by painting this color into the slashes and getting it on the flaps of the cloth that you just highlighted. And then it's easy to get discouraged. But what I found is you're just getting the color of the paint inside there. And if you do manage, or happen to, by poor luck, get some of the paint onto the flaps of the cloth, then all you have to do is go back over with your highlighting color and correct the mistake. In fact, I do get some paint on the cloth by accident. So you can see me going back over right now with the red and just kind of touching up the edges. Yeah, very simple. But yeah, I'm not sure what the state of Talibakland is, but the entire empire is kind of devastated by the End Times. Alright, so Ta'al is the Lord of Nature, the God of Nature, and so they really worship him. Talibaklanders, even their nobility, are unusually self-effacing. Their histories tell tales of great deeds while downplaying the role of the persons involved. They say that it's the doing that counts, not the one who does it. That's an old Talibakland saying, and at the tournaments held every 2 years at Kusul, Talibakland knights wear the provincial colors on their shields, the only indication of their families being a small badge on their shoulders. Tradition considers the glory won to belong to the people as a whole rather than to individual families or knights. And I think that's interesting. That's a very interesting sense of humility and maybe pride in the province rather than boastfulness and arrogance, which some of the other provinces are known for, especially the more militaristic ones, or even the capital province of Reykland. Then it says that Talabiklanders are a religious people. They revere all the gods of the empire, but they hold special reverence for Ta'al and Rhea, who is Ta'al's wife. Indeed, Ta'al's greatest temple is found in the small woods outside Talabheim in the great crater. Ulric, the god of wolves and the patron of Middenheim, is also popular, for although not braggarts, Talabiklanders are known for their warlike ways. Talabheim itself was the home of the cult of Ulric for a while in the second millennium, when Ar Ulric left Middenheim for Talabheim after a dispute with the Graf. And if you're not familiar with these terms, it can be kind of daunting, but Ar Ulric, as I guess the high priest of the god Ulric, he left Middenheim, which is the city of Ulric, for Talabheim because he got in a fight with the Graf, and the Graf is basically like the lord, the count. You can see that I made a little bit of a mistake with the red paint on the folds of the cloth, so I'm just covering it back up with some Flashgits yellow. Okay, this is one of my favorite parts from reading Sigmar's Heirs. When you look at the people of each of the provinces, it reads you what their best quality, at their best and at their worst. So it says that at their worst, Talabiklanders can be argumentative, primitive, hard-drinking, and mean to other people. Though they don't wear leaves, others accuse them of doing Talabiklanders generally eschew, Talabiklanders generally eschew elaborate clothes and prefer practical garb that can stand up to rough handling. So I'm moving on now to Othwan Grey to highlight the mustache and the beard. And I'm trying to stay at the tips and just kind of frost the color on here. Kitted out like a Reyklander is a popular expression for someone who dresses like a dandy. More than one effete stranger has been found tied upside down to a tree or worse. Talabiklander speech is smooth with slurred together words, though the cultured elites of Talabheim prefer to speak proper Reykspiel. Now we're going to highlight up the skin with Cadian flesh tone. The rest of the empire puts this curious speech down to the well-known Talabik tradition of brewing moonshine liquor in the woods. Many a prejudiced whisper speaks of wild parties held in the deeps of the woods, where semi-feral woodfolk gather to drink liquor, hunt game, and clamber into reeking sweat lodges. Each year, curious empire folk attempt to find and purchase some of the strange and varied alcohols to come out of Talabikland, with little success. Okay, so this is what I found really interesting about Talabikland. I don't know why I didn't catch it the first time I read it. Oh, I should really be watching this video. This is like one of my best face paint jobs that I've ever done. And I look back and I was like, wow, this actually came out pretty well. So I'm adjusting my light here. But I think one of the secrets was hitting the nose and then pulling the paint out towards the cheekbones and pulling the paint out towards the jawline. So you leave the shading in between the nose and the cheek and in the upper parts of the jawline. So you can kind of see there, if you take a look where the shading and the darker skin tone is still in. Gehenna's gold is used to highlight the gold now, and I'm trying to hit the curves, but to leave the Balthazar gold color kind of in the recesses to create a contrast with the shade. So the fact that they say that their speech is a little slurred together, their speech is smooth and slurred together. When I think of speech that's smooth and slurred together, I kind of think of speech like this. And when you find out that the Talabiklanders also have moonshine that they homebrew themselves, well, it kind of makes me think like, are these guys like Matthew McConaughey, backwoods, kind of like, I mean, I know that this is all the old world, is supposed to be Europe, specifically like Germany and different kinds of countries over there, but the fact that the writers in the fluff book point out that their speech is like that, I like that's just what comes to my head. Rackarth flesh, and the fact that they are kind of backwards and not into the elaborate clothes and prefer practical garb that can stand up to rough handling, that everything kind of reminds me of like backwoods, I don't want to say hillbillies, but you know, country folk. Good old down home country folk. Oh, maybe like southerners, like those like plantation owners. So rather than like hillbillies, maybe they are cultured plantation folk. Oh, that reminds me of Leonardo DiCaprio's character in Django. Okay, Ironbreaker is next. What I was doing with Rackarth flesh was I was painting the little stitching on the cover of the greatsword. I don't know what that's for. I was meaning to look that up, but I don't know why there's like a little bit of a wrapping around the greatsword. I don't even know if that's what it is, but that's kind of what I took it to be. So with the Ironbreaker, we're going to highlight the silver areas next. Alright, moving on. Talabiklenders resent any attempt to find out exactly how they worship Tal out in the woods. Indeed, freedom is very important to them. A man may think nothing of vanishing into the woods for weeks on end if the mood takes him. If that leaves behind a struggling wife and children, then so be it. For if Father Tal calls, one must answer. So that kind of gives you an idea of what the people are like. And yeah, they have this section in Sigmar's Heirs that is the sayings of Talabiklend. I think it's just hilarious. So I'll read you a couple. One of them that translates, "The woods whisper, but we shall never know." It means that it is a mystery. And another one says, "Gone to see if the leaves are green," means off on a drinking binge in the woods. So they're like, "Hey, where's Carl?" "Oh, he's done gone to see if the leaves are green." Means that he went off into the woods. It's funny. Yeah, they also have here the view of other people who then, when they ask these peasants and people, like, "Oh, what do you think of Talabiklend?" Then, what am I doing now? I'm trying to see if when is the part where I'm going for the eyes. I think this is it. Okay, so I got the fang, and what I'm doing is I'm trying to just put a glaze of thin down color. So the fang is the color that we're going to use, and I water it down a lot. And then what I'm trying to do is just paint it around the bags under his eyes. And what I end up doing, though, is deciding to just paint his eyeballs completely because I wasn't happy with the result. But a lot of figures, like if you look at my ogre models and even a lot of my empire figures, the effect of having some dark blue under the eyes is really, really good. It's a terrific effect. So these sayings are, let's see, an innkeeper, and as I'm doing this, I'm going to be painting on the slashes horizontally with Abaddon Black, and then inside that black, I'm going to be painting Ceramite White, and then I'm going to be painting vertical slashes to do the pupils of the eyeball. So that's what I'm going to be doing in the next couple of minutes. So an innkeeper says, "You want to find your way through the woods, boy, hire that Talabiklender there. No one knows the forest ways like them." Countess Elise Krieglitz of Talabheim says, "Through all the old world, though all the old world shall fall, Talabheim will resist to the last." I mean, that's pretty standard boasting. Let's see if we can find. A Nuln scholar from the city of Nuln says, "Tal is the special patron of Talabikland, but I imagine even he is embarrassed when one of his chosen falls down to worship a tree." So that's the view of a Nuln scholar. And then a Bretonian traveler has said of Talabiklend. And Bretonians, actually, I think they're supposed to be modeled after the French. So he says, I've drunk fine wines with emperors and tasted the most potent beer of the king of Karazakarak, but I have never encountered anything as strong as the homebrew thunder water of the Talabeklenders. My head still hurts. So, man, Sigmar's Heirs, I keep referring to it, even though it's so outdated because Warhammer Fantasy Roleplay is in the third edition. I keep referring to it because it is just fantastic resource for all of the provinces, especially if you're an Empire player, you want to paint an army of Empire, but you don't know which color scheme to go for because you've seen that there are lots of color schemes for the Empire on the Games Workshop website. Sigmar's Heirs, definitely a very good resource, along with Uniforms and Heraldry of the Empire for actual color schemes. I think those are all you need to get your creativity flowing. And another great thing is that Sigmar's Heirs includes significant places within each province. So there are some towns or cities that have been overrun or destroyed, or forests or locations like ruins of former heroes or nobles. And their estates, it's just a terrific resource to look at. And then you can say, oh, my greatsword here is a member of a unit that defends this city. And when you look at the city, then you see, okay, the city was known to be attacked by a beastmen herd, and it was defended only by the bravery of their greatswords or whatever. Then you could say that these guys were the ones, and they've got the beastmen's minotaur's head like on their standard because they've defended the town. I mean, it really fires your imagination, and it's one of the reasons why I love playing humans rather than goblins or more like swarm-minded things like Skaven or Tyranids, because each person has a personality and a background and a family, and they're so varied when you think of like orcs or you know, other species as just, you know, with a tribe, and not, and they could have a personality, but they're really, you know, there's nothing quite like having a history behind your little guys on the table. What I'm doing here is I'm painting Xandri Dust on the belt just to give it a little bit of a pop. And I think this is going to be it. So thanks for watching, everybody. Hope you enjoyed this little dive into the fluff. And again, straps there on the legs with Xandri Dust, and you're going to be done. So thanks for watching. Hope you got a little bit of entertainment or just, you know, keeping you company on your paint session. And thanks for watching the video. We'll see you in the next one. Latest players.